We're gonna start.
Okay.
Graphic design history has a problem. Much of it is either ending up in dumpsters or going unrecognized because it doesn't fit into the established canon or idea of what graphic design is. Without the proper archives and a diversity of materials and voices, much of graphic design history will disappear. But we have a solution. The People's Graphic Design Archive, a digital archive by everyone, about everyone, for everyone. This archive is different. The People's Graphic Design Archive includes not just finished products, but process, photos, videos, letters, documents, oral histories, anecdotes, articles, essays, and other writings. And best of all, it's created by us, the people. There are many types and combinations of visitors. They can browse or do a search for specific content. Entries feature subject, format, medium, designer, and date, along with other related information. Share, make sets, and leave comments if you have more to add to the story. The People's Graphic Design Archive is for research, education, inspiration, or just pure joy. We need your help to make the archive a reality. Join us in building the People's Graphic Design Archive.
DFA Spark series. My name is Alden Burke. I work at Design for America. I want to just start off by saying today is a really special session of the Spark series. It's brought to you in collaboration by DFA and Civilizations Design Lecture Series. So first and foremost, I want to thank Michael and Molly who are on this call for partnering and collaborating with us as always. Michael will share a little bit more about what Civilization is. But they're a great organization that we've had the chance to partner with a few times now. Actually, for a Sparks series that we did last fall, I'll be sharing that link in the chat with you all so you can check it out. I know there are a ton of familiar faces on this call, but for the Civilization audience, I just wanted to give a little bit of background about about what Design for America is. So we are a network that is really thinking about design and social impact. And that experience starts as a student experience in college campuses or now remote wherever students are, thinking about how to learn about design and social impact. Of course, students graduate and they become alumni who are thinking about how do I bring design sensibilities and collaboration and process into the workforce and the workplace. And of course, then those students and alumni bump into and work with community partners, design educators, and thinkers sort of throughout the country. And so this network is really a group of people who are always thinking about how do we teach design, how do we build community, and how do we create impact. And we were lucky enough to meet the folks at Civilization during the Cooper Hewitt Awards in 2018, yes. And so we've been able to partner with them on a number of programs. So we're really excited for this session today. Michael, I'm going to pass it to Michael in just a minute. He'll tell you about Civilization. And then Christen Carter is going to take it over, and then they will go into a Q&A. I'd encourage you all to use the chat as they're talking so you can ask questions that then can be sort of addressed during the Q&A portion. And then we'll also be sharing around some resources and information about further Sparks coming up. So with that, Michael, I will pass it to you.
Thank you, Alden. And thank you at home for joining us. I'm Michael Ellsworth from the design studio Civilization. We're honored to once again be collaborating with our friends at Design for America. Apart from our design work, our studio has always prioritized making design education accessible to our community. 6 years ago, we started our design lecture series, but due to the pandemic, our live events in Seattle have been put on pause. But we're thankful for partnerships like this. Thanks again, Design for America. I'm super excited to introduce you to our speaker today, Christen Carter. Christen is the founder of Busy Beaver Button Company in Chicago. They produce more than 30 million buttons for bands, artists, political campaigns, and more. In 2010, she started the Button Museum, dedicated to revealing American history through pinback buttons. Busy Beaver is truly an institution. It's a woman-owned business in a solar-powered geothermal green facility. In many ways, it's a model for American manufacturing. We've ordered countless of buttons from them, and over the years, we're fortunate to collaborate with their team on a vote button to help get out the vote in 2018. I voted. And if you haven't already voted, please do, as of this week, it is no longer recommended that you mail your ballot in. Please put on a mask and go to the polls or to a ballot box. All right, thanks again, everybody. And now I'll turn it over to Christen.
Hello. Thank you so much for having me here. Thank you to Design for America, built by Civilization, and you all for being here. It really is an honor to be able to talk about something that I really care about, and hopefully you find it interesting. My name is Christen Carter. I own a company called Busy Beaver Button Company, where we manufacture pinback buttons. I started it in 1995, and since then we've made over 50 million buttons. So it's been 25 years. I'm also the co-curator of the Button Museum, where we are trying to tell American history through pinback buttons. And that collection has about 40,000. And if you go to buttonmuseum.org, you will see about 8,000 of the buttons. We have a librarian that catalogs and archives them and puts them up onto the website. So, and then also I'm the co-author of a book that just came out. This is the cover of it and inside page called Button Power, 125 Years of Saying It with Buttons, where we show, so my friend Ted Hake and I worked on this together, we co-authored it, and where we're showing some of our favorite buttons from the last 125 years that we feel tell American history the best of all buttons. It displays about 1,500 buttons, and out of the tens of thousands that we talked about and we have seen, so it's definitely a very edited, book of images. But I'm really pleased with it, and I think we do the button right. So that's and so since this is Design for America, whose mission is to empower students by teaching design thinking to large-scale social problems, I thought we could focus today on solidarity. And, you know, we could talk a little bit about how buttons and their design communicate this idea of solidarity. And then also I'll talk about a very specific design element that probably represents solidarity better than any other icon, at least. So one of the things I love most about having the button business is that we are a hub for people up to stuff. So for the most part, people who come to order buttons from us have an idea that they want to share with others, and they want to build community around this idea. So we, you know, get to work with large scale organizations like Planned Parenthood and Every Town for Gun Safety and NRDC, National Resource Defense Council, and, you know, who are creating a lot of change by bringing a lot of people together. But then we also do buttons for smaller organizations that might not be as large, but are creating, you know, big impact in their immediate communities. So the design challenge with a button is to bring a larger idea into a very small space. and we have, I have a couple of rules of thumb that can kind of help with that. You know, they're just suggestions really. And for what makes an effective button design. And these rules can be broken and still be effective. One thing is the button should be recognizable, or the message should be understandable within about 3 seconds. So, you know, we walk past people all the time and, you know, you see them very briefly. So if someone sees the button, generally speaking, you want them to have an idea of, you know, of what it's about, very general, or at least pique their curiosity. It should also be something that people want to wear. So in this regard, it's mostly about messaging and or the aesthetics. For messaging, I have a quick little practice that helps people think into button size messaging, which is basically what is that you want to see? What is it that you want to see? What is the change? And then kind of going into why, until it feels very clear. And then, you know, how would your audience want to hear this? You know, and how, in a way that they would want to share it. So hopefully getting to the whys, you'll get to a very synthesized message. And then as far as design goes, it's really kind of a basic design concept of like speaking to your audience. And, and it goes a little further because in order to be effective, you need people to wear the button. So it, you know, they're literally standing behind it. So it's, it, you know, it's almost a piece of jewelry in some ways. I personally want buttons to be a force of good, especially during this time. One of the biggest concerns I have is that how divided we are as a country. So, and we've come to a point where we're not even really willing to, like hear each other out. And you know, we all seem to be getting information from different places too. So, and that's not helping. So we're lacking some common truths, but it does feel like talking about our personal values can help us bridge some of these gaps. You know, and building a national identity has been a concerted effort in this country since the foundation. There are some things that are like timeless, like liberty and freedom and, you know, pursuit of happiness. But, you know, what does that mean and how do we get there? And this is a constant problem to be solved. I was recently wearing my Black Lives Matter button, and I was talking to this guy, and he was like, I agree with that statement, but I don't agree with the movement. Or that with the organization. And I was like, you know, it led to a discussion where I think that, you know, the reason why I thought that the organization, the movement had to be taken, you know, should be taken seriously. And so we talked about several things and we had different opinions, but we had some commonality, which was we both think that police should wear body cameras. And now whenever I see him, he wants to talk politics. but which is great because there's movement happening, and that's okay. And the button did exactly what I wanted the button to do. And we were able to talk about these ideas of freedom and inequality. So that was, you know, I feel like the movement was very much worth it, the movement in us discussing it. And so buttons, you know, pretty much always show some type of solidarity, and that's why they're made in multiples, and they're a reflection of our personal identity. So I'm going to show you some inspiring designs from the past, and some of them in our book, Button Power. And here we go. I'll start off. So this is a button. It's a photograph. And it's an image, you can tell, of an American flag, and it looks kind of weird, but it's from 1899. And if you look closer, you'll see, like, all of these are people. They're little teeny people. And, you know, there's got to be, I mean, at least definitely hundreds, probably thousands of people making up this American flag. And it's called a living photograph. And, you know, it definitely speaks to the idea of, you know, national identity, meaning to me a group of people connected by ideals who want to work together to make life better for the group. I mean, I can hardly imagine how they got all these people together to do this photo. It's not easy. And this really speaks to the idea of national identity because it's literally a group of people coming together to make this flag happen. I mean, it's an American flag even, you know. And then somebody was like, oh, we need to make a memento of this so we can share it. And they made buttons. For the rest of the talk, I'm going to talk mostly about this iconic symbol for solidarity and forward movement on social causes. So the origin, it's the raised fist, by the way. The origin is kind of unknown, but there was a poster with a raised fist in a 1914 poster for illustration for industrial workers of the world, Chicago organization. Anti-fascists used it against the Nazi Party as well, and it's had a long international journey through history. It's always calling for social change and always for solidarity. In the 1960s, it became, you know, people were using it for, like, Students for a Democratic Society and the Black Panthers, you know, organizations fighting for equality. But then probably one of the most famous moments is right here. This is 1968 during the Olympics, where Tommy Smith and John Carlos won the gold and the bronze in the 200-meter race. So, and then they raised their fists during the national anthem, the U.S. national anthem, which was Star-Spangled Banner, which another flag. But I'm going to show you some different ways that people showed this, like the raised fist, and used it in button design. Black Panthers. This is such a cool design. I mean, the color use is beautiful. And then also, you can tell there's that line where the red and the blue kind of meet. And it's almost like they didn't let one color dry before they did the other color because they, like, had to get these out, get them in the streets. Beautiful button. This one's super creative. This is American Libraries Association, the Black Caucus. So they made this raised fist out of books, which it's just such a sweet design, such a good use of the symbol and combining it with their particular, reason. So it's, cool button. Easy to understand when you see it. I mean, the fist is pretty recognizable, and then you have to go into it to see that it's books, I think, but it's like the female symbol, kind of turned feminist symbol from the early 70s with the solidarity fist. So it can be worn by men, women, anyone. And then similarly, but it has a Star of David in the middle. So it's some type of Jewish women solidarity. This is the Young Workers Liberation League. and it's obviously talking about race and skin color with all the different colors they have there. So it's, you know, this is exactly like, this is pretty much solidarity in a button right here. at least racial. This is one of my very favorites as far as design goes. I mean, how beautiful is this illustration and the way that the hand is drawn, and immediately you know what this button is for. You know, it's science for the people. It's, you know, access to scientific information, being being in science and all that. But it's a wonderful button. This one really gets me. I love it. So the circle design in the middle is ecology, symbol for ecology, for the environment. And I don't know what the square is about, but it's also, it's a weird use of space, but it's cool. You know, it's the thing that I really like about this one, though, is the drawing, how the fist is drawn. It's just so heartfelt. It's not super like skilled as far as like, you know, it's not very professional necessarily, but it's grassroots and you work with what you got. And I think it's just super charming. Another great use of the raised fist. This is for the AFL-CIO in Wisconsin. It's probably like, I don't know, 8 to 10 years old. But if you're from Wisconsin or if you're familiar with Wisconsin, this is the state shape. And they made a fist out of the state shape. And it's kind of interesting. They have like the little, where is that? Door County, that little area, just kind of like a shard coming off it, but still super recognizable. And yeah, and a more recent example of it. I don't know why this particular one was made, but I find it really charming because it's just like, solidarity, period. Farrah Manufacturing was a company that the workers were trying to unionize. So this was boycott Farrah pants until they unionized. So this is solidarity to boycott. Another beautiful icon all over the place. We have the female feminist kind of icon, and then the orange and the yellow is the nuclear symbol. And it's just beautiful use of colors and also very striking. One of the things that I like about this is how they just kind of forewent the wrist, and they're just the fist, because it fits so perfectly in that little center circle. And it still conveys the message, you know, well. Movement on trial, Oakland 7, seven people who were in jail for anti-war protests. While I focused on buttons during this talk, I mean, there's so many ways to show solidarity. It's like, it's infinite. It's activities, it's gestures, it's, you know, donations of time and money and encouragement and kindness and legislation. And the buttons are one tool that have historically helped build community to create change. I'm open for questions if anybody has them. And I'm just going to leave this here for a minute because it's almost Halloween. Oh, wait. There we go. Hello.
Oh, everybody.
Can I start off?
Yes.
So, hi, Christen. Hey, everybody. I'm actually, Kristen's one of my neighbors. I'm right down the street right now. And one thing I want to tell people and one question I want to ask. So it's like a factory. You place an order. They help you with your design. It's really fabulous. So you can't usually walk in and buy anything. But Christen, if I go down to the shop right now, do you have any vote buttons that I can get in bulk? Or is everything always order?
Things are mostly in order. I mean, I'm sure we have a couple around that you could pick up if you want, but
I mean, like 100.
Yeah, if you have, I mean, we could probably come up with a design for you if you want to do something like that. It'd be pretty easy to do. So yeah, you I think you have my email, right, from the
yes.
community? Yeah.
Yeah.
Drop me a line.
Okay. I'm thinking specifically of the one that's vote, V-O-T-E, that looks like the love symbol from Love Story.
Oh, okay.
But, okay, thank you.
Yeah, thank you. Thanks, Chris.
Kristen, thank you for that great talk. Very insightful. Everybody, chat your questions and I will ask them. We've got a few from the audience, but I just wanted to punctuate because I saw this in the chat. Big ideas into a small space. That's a really great idea. And I just love the idea of that. It's distributed into the streets and it's, you know, self-identifying. Such a great format for design and for messages.
Yeah, I didn't really talk much about the self-identifying, but it's sort of like part of the pleasure. It's like you're connecting yourself to this thing, you know, and you're like willing to bring it into your own identity, which is a beautiful thing.
Yeah. Well, just before I ask, just to get into that, like one of my favorite collaborations that you all did was the Milton Glaser collaboration. And I had the honor to interview the late, great Milton. And he was talking about that project and he was talking about how like the real design problem is breaking in. The real design problem is distribution. And buttons is such an amazing format for that. Like yeah. We all can show what we believe in to our politicians, to our leaders and show this.
Yeah. And part of it was, you know, he wanted to make a movement that was inexpensive, you know? So exactly. He was like, you know, they could afford buttons and then pass them out, you know, because they're like 25 cents each or whatever, you know?
So, and it was like buy one and get three for your friend, like for other yeah. people. Brilliant.
Yeah, that's such a good idea. Yeah. Exactly, building community right there.
Absolutely. So I'm going to ask a question from Kent. Hey, Kent, it's good to see you. Kent is led an amazing design department from Western Washington University, but now he is doing his own thing. And thank you for joining us, Kent. Love it. He asks, what's the oldest button in the collection? What's the largest button? And what's the process to donate buttons?
Wow. Okay, the oldest button, well, we have a lineage. So we have a pre-button little section of the Button Museum, which starts with George Washington's inauguration. So he was inaugurated in 1789 and everyone was so excited. They started a country. So, oh, I should mention at his inauguration, he had like buttons on his jacket, like clothing buttons. And, you know, so everyone was excited. They started country. So, they made souvenirs and so that's kind of why we call them buttons, and that's like the ancestor button. And then there wasn't much of a two-party system, so there wasn't really people, you know, expressing their political alliances. But the very first button after it was patented, or actually even before it was probably patented, I don't know, but was 1896 when the button was invented. So there's steps that get us there, but the patent of the button as we know it is from 1896. So we definitely have like a lot of buttons from 1896 and for the last 125 years. And honestly, if you want to start your own collection, if you wanted to get like some of the earliest buttons, like some of them are, you know, $5 or less from like 125 years ago. So, I mean, there's definitely ones that are more valuable and everything, but yeah. And then the biggest button we have is a 10-inch button. We have one, and that's the biggest one I've ever found. And 9-inch you can find. 6-inch you can find. And actually the very biggest button is Busy Beaver. We have a sign out in front of our facility and we made a 3-foot button. So, and it actually has a pin on the back and everything. It's a legitimate button. And I figured out if it was on the Statue of Liberty, it would be about this size. It would be about a 1 1/4. This is a 1.5, but so yeah, that's the very biggest. And what was the last question? Oh, how to donate. You can contact us at museum@busybeaver.net because we're not, museums, we're closed to the public right now until, you know, people can kind of start. And but we've been getting actually a lot just mailed to us. And that, I don't know, like I could talk, it's such an honor to have people's buttons and their collections. And I tell this story, but there's a woman who is a nun and like social justice fighter and in Detroit, and she gave us her buttons from the 60s to the 90s. So, and then, you know, she got to tell, I mean, we got to hear her stories about what she was fighting for and stuff like that. And I mean, what an honor to be able to house some people's personal histories like this.
Thank you. We've got one from Allison Jackson. I'm curious if you can speak to how buttons as communication tools have changed with the ways digital tools now dominate our communication patterns in social spaces.
Yeah, I mean, how they've changed. I mean, maybe this will kind of jostle an idea, but I can say that, you know, with social media tweets, like a tweet might be the closest thing to a button, you know, as far as like how we communicate, and because it's small and it's temporary. I guess most all is temporary, but you know, the biggest deal difference is that you're like, well, that you're standing behind it, that you're actually wearing the thing. So it's not as anonymous, you know, and it's not, and it's designed too. So, you know, you don't, you get attachments, but you know, but you don't really get the design. So how has it changed? I mean, how it's designed has changed. So, you know, using computers rather than like photographing illustrations and all that stuff, and how it's printed. So it's mostly digitally printed now, instead of like letterpress or offset or however, all the ways that commercial print in the last 125 years. So, you know, it's surprising, like there's a lot of buttons from the 20s and even earlier, like some of the very first buttons were these like slogan buttons that are just icebreakers that would say like, you know, penny for yours. I can't remember actually one of them off the top of my head, but just kind of funny little like icebreakers. So that kind of gets people talking, and that's not stopped, you know, like that's been pretty consistent where it's just a slogan on a button that tries to pique people's curiosities and get them talking with each other. But design has changed in that it's a lot simpler to do, a lot more for color because it's easier to do. And then with computers, it's just easier to design in some ways, you know, in so many ways, like lettering and all that stuff. I don't know if that really answers your question, but
yeah. Well, I just wanted to add, because we had some other questions on this about the manufacturing process, is that also, I believe you all have automatic machines and you're not just like pulling down the lever on.
Yeah.
Could you speak?
They're semi-automatic. They need to be, it's like a sewing machine sort of where you manually have to like put the parts in and then, but it's a foot pedal. So it kind of goes and stops.
Oh, so there's a human interaction.
Oh yeah. Huge human interaction. Huge. I mean, I don't know. Everything's cut manually and, you know, parts are put in there, you know, and it's actually important because that's the way we make sure quality happens. So it has all these points of, we have like a multi-point quality inspection process at Busy Beaver.
How do you see young people engaging and interacting with the buttons? Do they have as much staying power and influence when information is often passed around digitally? That is from Design for America.
So what's it like, young people using buttons, or what was it kind of like?
I can tie in two questions I'm seeing in the chat. It's how basically digital tools and young people are using them, and then like in quarantine, have you seen anything like, I guess in the last 5 years, like of how people are using buttons?
Yeah, I mean, I think, in the last 4 years, it feels like people are more outspoken about their, the issues that they care about. So I feel like there's definitely been like an uptick in button wearing. I'm not really sure exactly how to answer that question. But yeah, definitely a lot more social issues. And then a lot of art buttons. So a lot of illustrators and designers and stuff just use them as art, and they sell them as part of their shop or at like zine fests and stuff like that. So that's been kind of going on for the last 10 years, but I love those buttons because you know, it's just getting to see people's art, you know? And that's also one of the big things that's, you know, like Busy Beaver, like we're a hub for people doing stuff, you know? So, you know, that's why they make stuff. So I get to see kind of what people are thinking about, at least our customers. And we work a lot of designers and creative people and a lot of national organizations. So, and some of them are like shifting towards more social justice stuff, you know?
Julia Davidson asks, do you have a collection of litho tabs that we used to get from buying a ticket at museums? She said like history, like of the MCA in Chicago, like the little, those types of buttons.
I have like a little ancillary collection of them. They're not buttons in my definition of buttons. They're definitely wearable insignia. I mean, there are litho buttons that aren't tabs because they have like a pin in the back. And those are invented in Chicago. Chicago's a very buttony city historically. They're invented in Newark, New Jersey. But the earliest button we've ever found was for an organization in Indiana, so close by. But we have some of the tabs, they're not on display. So the Button Museum has like 8,000 buttons on display. So if you go to buttonmuseum.org, you can see them, but I don't think there are any tags in there. I think we've not been putting them up, but I love them. I mean, they're so fun. And those are very temporary, you know, and that the printing methods, it's litho, it's called, and it's like a less expensive, higher quantity way to make these tabs or, you know, wearable insignia of different kinds.
So if it doesn't have a pin back, it sounds like it's not in the museum. Is that a?
Well, it's complicated. So if it's made with button machinery, so there's some big like 9-inch FDR buttons of just like his head bust. And they don't have a button on the back, but it's a button, it's made with a button machine, but it has like a little hook or a little like thing that you can put it on the wall. And then there are button machinery paperweights and hand mirrors and stuff like that. So I still consider those buttons-ish, you know, like we will display those for sure. But I think coming from a manufacturing angle, I'm like, well, it's made with button machinery. We make hand mirrors and we make magnets and stuff. So out of buttons. So.
I love your magnets personally. That's my, I ordered so many magnet bags. And that was another question. Is there other ways for buttons that other than sticking them through clothes? Yes, you should check their website. There are many applications. Ross Brunetti asks, is there thoughts about sustainability of buttons? They seem to be made so quickly, but where do they end up? If not at the museum, where should they end up? And then earlier it was about like sustainable materials. And I was wondering from the industry perspective of button making, are there becoming more sustainable materials?
I think so. I mean, we use as much as we like, and we're always improving in that regard. You know, we have the solar and the geothermal that you mentioned, but also we have, we use 100% recycled paper and, our steel is made out of some recycled like post-consumer recycled, like 25%. And that's something that I want to get better at. I've been doing research on that, and there's opening up 100% recycled steel. Like plants that process that. So we'll see how that comes along in the next year or something. And as far as recycling buttons, we do, they are recyclable. So what we have is, well, in Chicago, there are people who come around and just like take your stuff from the alley, you know? So we made friends with a guy who comes around our alley whenever we have stuff to get recycled. So he just comes and picks it up. And so yeah, he lives down the street. So he just comes by, picks him up and brings him to recycling for us.
That's awesome. And I think that's as designers and all the designers in this Zoom call, that's our responsibility, is to create something that people don't want to throw away. They want to keep it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and that's the thing. Like buttons could be mementos if they're designed and created thoughtfully. I think people like to just keep them, you know, like the nun from Detroit, you know, like those were very meaningful to her. So
we have time for one last question, maybe two. This is interesting, from Jesse. Could you give a rough breakdown of the button demographics that Busy Beaver produces, i.e. 20% bands, 30% political, 2% art?
Yeah.
Curious about what industries are the making the most buttons.
I guess I would say it used to be like when I first started, because I kind of started from like punk rock DIY kind of background in 1995 when I started Busy Beaver. And so then it was like 90% bands, you know, maybe 10% zines or something like that. And then now we still do a lot of band buttons, but it depends on the year. So election years, it could be 50% political, or maybe not quite that, but maybe 40%. We do measure this stuff, but it does kind of change. Not everybody's categorized, you know, so I don't really have a actual metrics, you know, for this answer, but my gut would say on a non-election year, nonprofits are probably the biggest. So museums, cause-based organizations. So I would say that's like 40, like 35% maybe. And then bands might be 10-ish percent, 10 to 15, and then art about the same. So, and then small business or businesses, like we'll do WordPress buttons, like they're probably 20%. I don't know if this is adding up to 100%, but.
Well, it sounds like it ebbs and flows depending on the year, the topics around. And,
yeah, totally.
All right, last question.
Okay.
You ever created a button with an idea that you disagreed with?
Okay. Yes, absolutely. we do have a policy, no bootleg or bigot buttons, we call them, just because it starts with a B. You know, any hate type button, so hate speech. So not any type of hate button, but if it's towards a group of people, you know, it could be like, I hate cheesecake, and that's fine. But so we do turn away some orders. Like especially if it's copyright infringement. And if it is hate, but we really only, I don't think people who want to make those buttons really come to us because they might see who we are and stuff. But, and if it is something that I disagree with, but it doesn't really fall into those two categories, like I personally just kind of donate the money, and I don't really like talk about where I'm giving the money or even talk about it publicly unless like, I guess somebody's asking me like
Yeah, I get asked that question a lot.
I mean, I do believe in freedom of speech and expression, and I have to believe in expression to have a button company. You know, it's just, every once in a while, but I, you know, and yeah, so that's kind of, that's kind of where we stand on that.
I think your answer about like it's who you put out, like what you put out in the world is attracts that type of client, right? Like we get asked that all the time. It's like the phone doesn't really ring with, or people aren't reaching out to us with those types of projects. And I'm assuming just the same as your organization, it's not very attracting that audience. It's probably kind of alienating or repelling that audience naturally, which is great. Then you know you're doing the right thing.
Our customers are the best. Like I love our customers so much.
Well, I want to thank you.
We probably have like, I don't know, thousands of oh, sorry.
Oh, go ahead.
Delay.
Well, I just want to thank you. We're it's out of time, and I want to turn it over to the Design for America folks. But thank you so much, Christen. It was awesome to work with you on preparing for this and chatting with you. And thank you all for joining us on this middle of the day. And it was so good to see some familiar names and faces. And thanks to Design for America. I'll turn it over to Alden.
Thank you, everyone, for the good question.
Yeah. Thanks, Christen. Thanks, Civilization. As always, it's a I wasn't muted. Sorry, I thought I was muted for a second. I'm not. Thanks all for being here. It's always really great to be working with you all. I wanted to invite everyone in this chat today to continue joining us for the Spark series. I just sent the link. The next one, we're going to have an off week next week, but the November 11th session is a reflection roundtable on political participation, practice, and presence. With a few different speakers. It's going to be really great. And then we also wanted to share one of the new things we're doing with these Spark sessions is creating a resource list and a sort of sheet for people to opt into if they want to stay connected. So in the first tab, I just chatted it. There's some resources and things that were shared today, including Christen's book and the Button Museum. So you all have the links to that. And then on the second tab, there's a connect with participants. If you are really excited by the people asking fantastic questions today, feel free to connect with them over sort of email, LinkedIn, et cetera. But thanks all for a great session. It was really nice to see everyone. And we'll have a great rest of your Wednesday. And vote and wear your buttons. Thanks all. Bye, everyone.